a message series called Jesus People, People Being Changed by Jesus. Now, we started out with Nicodemus last week. If you were on Monday night, you heard me preach on Silas. Today, before we get into this week's Jesus People, we've been talking about some characteristics that real Jesus people have. I gave you four or five last time. Here's another four. One, they're faithful in little so they can be set over much. That they understand the importance of doing the little things the right way. If you do the little things like they're big things, God will do big things like they are little things. That if you're faithful with your first part of the day, he can do a lot with the rest of the day. If you're faithful with the first day of the week, he can do a lot the rest of the week. That Jesus people know the importance of being faithful in the little. Jesus people know, like at work and in life, that if you're too big for a small job, you'll be too small for a big job one day. Being faithful with a dollar before you think you'll be faithful with $10 or $1 million. See, Christians and Jesus people, they understand it's about being faithful what's right in front of you. How about this one? Praise is given, not received. Now, when I was going to church as a kid, we didn't have these kind of instruments. We had an organ, and we had Miss Texie Coleman. She's about 80 years old. She had purple hair, and she was getting down on that organ. But I remember going, when I tuned in the radio, I don't hear organs. But when I go to church, I got organs, okay? So I'm praising God by an organ. Why? Because it's what I'm giving, not what I'm receiving. That I can give God glory anyway. I can worship him in the morning, in the evening. I can worship him any kind of music. Why? It's about giving God worship, not receiving it. Some people are like, I didn't get anything out of worship. Well, you weren't supposed to. What'd you give? Oh, am I preaching too early? Now listen, come on. We think that what? We want a cruise ship at church, don't we? Like, hey, take care of me. I want this. I like that. Well, I like that a lot. Give me some more of that. And it's like, wait a minute. That's not what we're here about. We're here to give praise, not receive it. Well, we're not a cruise ship. We're a fishing vessel. We're a rescue ship. We're a battleship. We give God praise all the time, that we can give him praise in any circumstance. Jesus people know that adversity is average. It's par for the course, isn't it? That if you're a Christian, you don't get rainbows and butterflies. If you're a Christian, you know that there is an enemy, that you're going to have an adverse situation. The more steps of faith you take, the bigger target on your chest you get. Now, the good news is, greater is he who is in me than he who is in the world. But you better be ready for a fight, because it's coming your way. Be prepared. Ephesians 6:10, put on the full armor of God to know adversity is coming. And Jesus people aren't surprised when it comes. And they're built to last through it. That adversity is really just average. Now, some of you go, well, I'm not really facing any adversity. You're probably not doing much for God. And then he's like, I'm just going to leave you the way you are, because you got it all about you and you're not making a difference, but you think you're making a difference, so he's going to do it. Jesus people are found people who find people. See, when you found salvation, when you found a personal relationship with Jesus, you can't help but to tell people and to share with them and to get you want to bring them to where Jesus is at. Why? Because you're found. I have cracked the code on the restaurant BJ's Pizookie. You know, a little dessert. Now, in my opinion, the best dessert is hot and cold at the same time. That's what makes it a good dessert. You have a hot element and you have a cold element. Now, they have this thing called Pizookie, and it's basically these different types of cookies, and they put ice cream on. They're delicious. They have about 12 or 14 different varieties. They're always trying to find the perfect combination. I have found it. It's a white chocolate macadamia nut Pizookie, but you ask for not crushed, but whole candy pecans. That one comes on the brownie one, but you ask it for the white chocolate. You put that on there, and when I get it, my first spoonful, I'll give it to somebody else. I'll say, why? Because I'm trying to convince them it's the best. I can't help it, right? I'm like, listen, what you ordered is wrong. Next time, order this. It's good, isn't it, right? It's just that sharer in me. And I'm telling you, when you have found Christ, it's no longer about your preference. You're like, man, I've been reached. Listen, don't worry about catering to me, but man, I would love for my kids to go to church or my neighbor to go to church or my coworker to go to church. So you just keep reaching them. It's not about my preference. Why? Because found people find people. Some of you know about the Moravian Revival. It lasted 100 years, 1727, and they had a novel idea. They said, you know what? We're going to pray around the clock, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. And they looked at Scripture and said, you know what? We're going to send out missionaries two by two. And they did it for 100 years. And you might be familiar, two of the missionaries there that were coming out of Germany at the time, there was an island that was a slave island. The only way, only people on the island were either slaves or slave owners. And these two missionaries decided to sell themselves into slavery so they could get on the boat and go to the island and tell people about Jesus. And history records that as they're on the boat and they're leaving, their family is on the shore. And you know the last thing they heard those two men say? Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the Lamb. Go ahead, don't worry about me. I've got a relationship with Christ. He's worth it. He's worthy. Why? Because found people find people. All right. This morning we're going to get into Zacchaeus, Jesus people, Zacchaeus, Luke chapter 19. Now, let me go ahead and show you a picture of Zacchaeus. There he is. So let's go ahead and just get this out of the way, okay? Hit play. If you know the song, sing along. Go ahead and just get this over with, okay? That's enough. Thank you. Now, if you, by the way, that was shot in 1995. Those stripes are coming back, man. Just fashion just keeps making circles, doesn't it? And if you grew up in any type of church setting, you remember singing that song. But today, I want us to look at the life of Zacchaeus and look how he became Jesus' people. The story is in Luke chapter 19, and I want to start by reading the first two verses. It says, this is talking about Jesus. He entered Jericho and was passing through, and behold, there was a man named Zacchaeus. He was a chief tax collector and was rich. It starts out by saying he entered Jericho and was passing through. This is at the end of Jesus' three-year ministry. He's heading into Jerusalem for the Passover and to be put on the cross. And he has a huge caravan that's coming with him through this area. Now, Jericho was a very plush, lush place. That part of southern Judea, it had the cypress trees and the sycamore trees, and it had the rose gardens. Historians say that there was rose gardens as far as the eye could see in Jericho. In fact, the word Jericho, it means perfumed. It means there was an aurora, there was a smell. This is where everyone wanted to come and to live. So they protected it. There were four or five military posts there. And a lot of wealthy people lived in Jericho. And because there was a lot of wealthy people, there was a lot of thieves as well. You may remember when Jesus was telling the parable about the Good Samaritan who got robbed and beaten. It said what? He was on the road to Jericho. And so it's a town where a lot of people would travel through, and tourists and people wealthy. And this is the scene as Jesus is coming through Jericho in a big caravan, and we're introduced, and behold, there was a man named Zacchaeus. Zacchaeus' namesake means pure and righteous one. But yet it says that Zacchaeus was a tax collector. And if you're familiar with first century Roman and Jewish rule, that tax collectors were the worst of the worst. They would take advantage of their own people. So the Roman Empire would hire Jewish tax collectors to tax the Jewish people. And they said, listen, hey, here's what we calculate, but you can take whatever you want. And so they were extorting their own people. Even in our country, it's a capital charge of treason that you're going against your own people. And that's what they were doing. They were extorting their own people. And so when they're, it's like murderers, adulterers, tax collectors. I mean, they were in that category. And we learned that Zacchaeus was not only a tax collector, he was what? Chief tax collector. That meant he had tax collectors underneath him. So he's probably in the take that thinks about 25 to 30% above what's required, he's able to put in his back pocket. Now, Zacchaeus, because this was what? He was very wealthy. Now, you remember, give me some context of where we're at in Scripture. Just before this, Jesus came upon what? The rich young ruler. And he said, what must I have to have eternal life? And Jesus spoke to what really his heart issue was. And he said, hey, go sell all your possessions. And he said, the rich young, he walked away sad. Why? Because he loved his stuff more than following the Savior. And then his disciples are walking down the road and they're going, man, what does it take for a rich person to go to heaven? And Jesus said, it's hard. It's like what? A camel going through the eye of a needle. And Jesus said, with man, it's impossible, but what? With God, all things are possible. And now God is now showing them what that looks like at this next stop in Jericho as this very wealthy tax collector is there. Now look at verse 3. And he was seeking to see who Jesus was, but on account of the crowd, he could not, because he was small in stature. So he ran on ahead and climbed up into a sycamore tree to see him, for he was about to pass that way. We have some more information about Zacchaeus here. One, he was seeking to see Jesus. So he has come to catch this caravan of Jesus coming through his town and his city. We learned that he was short in stature. Now, historians and archaeologists tell us that in first century, the average height of a man was right at 5 feet. So if that's the average height, you can imagine that his how short of a man he actually was. And his stature was noticeable. But come on, Zacchaeus was really smart, okay? He's getting 25% extra off of you, and that's his job, and he's wealthy. So what is Zacchaeus do? Even though he had some obstacles physically, he said, okay, this crowd who doesn't like him, obviously he extorts them. It's like they're making room for him. He goes, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to get ahead of the crowd. And I want you to know, some of you are with the crowd. That's what keeping you from seeing Jesus. That you notice the crowd, just for whatever reason, Jesus doesn't come up. It doesn't stir your faith up. In fact, it takes you away from it. So Zacchaeus said, you know what I'm going to do is I'm going to, it says, run ahead. Now, a dignified person, a publican would never run. You had long robe, you had to pick your robe up and run. But Zacchaeus, I want to see this guy. And so he ran ahead of the crowd. He's like, you know what? I bet they're going to come around, and I bet they're going to go right by that sycamore tree. That's where I'm going to go. And of course, the sycamore tree, the branches were lower, but they were strong. They could hold his weight. And so there's Zacchaeus sitting by himself at this sycamore tree, waiting for the crowd and the caravan to come his way. Let me ask you a question. Why did he climb the tree? Why did Zacchaeus climb the tree? Well, one, it could be because he couldn't see, right? He wanted to get a view, and so he climbed upon the limb. But could there be more? Maybe Zacchaeus was he was curious about this man named Jesus. In just a week or so, they're all going to say, Hosanna, Hosanna. He had throngs of followers. He was known for preaching sermons and healing people. And maybe he was like, man, who is this guy? I want to find out from my own eyes who he is. Maybe he had heard about Levi, another tax collector, who was one of Jesus' disciples, who gave up being a tax collector and being, man, I got to find out what happened to Matthew. What happened to Levi? He's following this guy. Maybe it was just some curiosities in Zacchaeus, why to get up there. Maybe it was his conscience. Maybe he was tired. Maybe he was like, you know, I really didn't want to become this way. And maybe his conscience was bothered. Like, you know what, I started out just taking 2%. And then I started taking 5%, and then 10%, and then 20%, and 25%. I mean, I just let greed invade my heart. Now no one likes me, and maybe it's, I can't do this anymore. Like, I'm tired of stealing from people. I'm tired of being crooked. And maybe his conscience was just weighing on him. Maybe he was looking for compassion. You know, the religious people in that day walked around town with big phylacteries and long fringes, and they would take the places of honor. And Jesus was so harsh to these people. And did you know tax collectors couldn't go to the synagogue? So the only religious people he knows are people who goes, hey, you can't be around us. You can't come to church with us. You're a tax collector. Stay away. And maybe he heard that Jesus had compassion on people and compassion on the crowds, and goes, maybe Jesus can show compassion on me. Or maybe Zacchaeus was really lonely and he was looking for companionship. Maybe he could be in a crowd but feel all alone. And maybe people knew him, but he didn't know anyone. Maybe Zacchaeus climbed that tree to see Jesus, or maybe for Jesus to see him. And maybe he realized life is not about the wealth, that I need fellowship, I need real friendship. Verse 5, and when Jesus came to the place, he looked up and said to him, Zacchaeus, hurry and come down, for I must stay at your house today. So he hurried and came down and received him joyfully. Now, Jesus comes, and Zacchaeus was right, wasn't he? They did. They came right by that tree. And Jesus comes to that spot, and before Zacchaeus says anything, Jesus looks at him and calls him by name and says, Zacchaeus. Now, maybe their paths had crossed before. Maybe Matthew at the dinner of tax collector, he became a follower. Maybe he had talked about the Zacchaeus in Jericho, or maybe not. And most likely not. But Jesus knew what Zacchaeus needed, and Jesus said his name, Zacchaeus. And Jesus said, hurry and come down, for I must stay at your house today. Now, the next verse is the most mind-blowing verse in this whole passage, and no one ever preaches about it. I don't understand. I mean, they probably do, but you don't hear much. Look what happened next. Here is Zacchaeus, and what does he say? So he hurried and came down and received him joyfully. Wow. He obeyed Jesus in that moment. That, by the way, Jesus either spoke to him or looked at him. He knew he could be trusted, and he obeyed Jesus, and he hurried down that tree and what? Joyfully received him. What a moment. Now, in that day, that embrace would have probably been a kiss on the cheek and an embrace. And it's amazing to me everyone knew how crooked Zacchaeus was. And Jesus looked at him saying, why don't you hurry on down here? And Zacchaeus and Jesus embrace in this moment. They received him joyfully. There's good stuff coming the rest of the story. But at that moment, that's all they have. And they embraced in that moment. This weekend was another great weekend at the church. And thank you guys for participating in all your prayers. Friday, you know, the marriage retreat started, and then Saturday morning we had the 5K, and Kelly and I came out, we ran the 5K together, we went back to the marriage retreat, and after church day, we're going to our prison ministries, doing Kairos weekend, and we're going to go and celebrate closing ceremonies at 3 o'clock today, but at the marriage retreat, and Troy and Tracy did a great job, if you ever get a chance to go, you need to go, But there's a part where they gave us a little blanket, and we were having lunch on the lawn. And I was telling Kelly, I was like, man, I love this weekend. I said, hey, next year we can do this, and we can do this, and we can do this, and we can do this. And Kelly just put her hand on my leg, because she loves me and knows me, and says, hey, why don't we enjoy this year? And she said this. She said, remember Chuck's 49th birthday. Now, what she was telling me in that moment is going, well, hey, let's receive this moment joyfully that we got. Now, my brother's 49th birthday, you know what I talked to my brother about? The majority of our conversation on his 49th birthday, you know what we talked about? His 50th birthday. Hey, it's the big 5-0. What are you going to do? How about this? How about this? How about this? And my brother didn't make it to 50 on the side. He passed away. And I live with that regret that there were there to celebrate his 49th birthday. And I talked about something I thought was a for sure thing, but it really wasn't, was it? Zacchaeus hurried down from that tree, and he received him joyfully. Let me ask you a question. Who is seeking who at this point? We got Zacchaeus on one hand, that finds out that Jesus is coming through his city, so he comes down, the crowd is keeping him, so he runs ahead, he hops on a tree so he can see Jesus, but yet here comes Jesus going to Jerusalem, goes to Jericho, stops right where Zacchaeus is, and says, Zacchaeus, I'm coming to your house today. Who is seeking who? And isn't this a beautiful picture of the gospel, how it works? See, we know Romans 10:13 says what? Whoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Whoever. It's for anyone. And I imagine like a doorpost, and you see that whoever calls upon the name of, and you remember that time where you go, you know what? I'm ready to receive Christ. And you separate yourself and you go, Lord, I choose you to be my Savior. And you repented and you received it. And you walk through that door and say, I choose you, Jesus. And then you look back at that doorpost. And it says, before the foundations of the earth, I chose you. What? He chose me. He was working all that out my life. I thought I was seeking him, but he was seeking me. Do you see the beautifulness of the gospel? And here's Zacchaeus seeking Jesus, and here's Jesus seeking Zacchaeus. Verse 7, and when they saw it, the crowd, they all grumbled. He has gone in to be the guest of a man who is a sinner. Both Zacchaeus and Jesus had opposition from the crowd about this dinner. It said what? All grumbled. That means even his disciples. Judas was just one more away. Do you remember? Because in a few days, the woman's going to come and break open an alabaster jar of perfume that's worth a year's worth of wages, and she's going to pour it on the feet of Jesus, and the disciples say, what? What a waste. That's a year's worth. We could have fed the poor. And Judas is like, I'm done with this guy. I'm leaving. He leaves to go arrange his 30 pieces of silver. The disciples all are like, you've chosen this guy to have dinner with? Zacchaeus? Do you understand? We're in a town of influence. You're about to, we want you to go set up the kingdom in Jerusalem to defeat Rome. You know all the people we could have lunch today? Do you see the crowd following you? And you chose another sinner like Zacchaeus? So Jesus dines with Danny DeVito. No offense, Danny DeVito, if you see this. You know, and I wish we had the conversation at that dinner. And in verse 8, Zacchaeus says this, and Zacchaeus stood and said to the Lord, behold, the Lord, the half of my goods I give to the poor, and if I have defrauded anyone of anything, I restore it fourfold. There is a small minority, I am not in this group, that thinks Zacchaeus said this before the dinner. as some attempt to earn his salvation or righteousness. Like, hey, I know I'm a bad guy, but I'll do a good thing and make an empty promise to God. I don't believe that. I believe this is after his encounter with Jesus. I'll give you a few reasons as we go through this. But after this dinner with Jesus, this afternoon with Jesus, Zacchaeus stood and said, behold, Lord, half of my goods I give to the poor, and whatever I've defrauded anyone of anything, I'll restore it fourfold. Why? Because this sounds a lot like grief for sin. And if people's hearts are hardened or they're lost, they don't care about their sin. But he has grief. He knows that, man, I've done wrong. Before you can embrace the good news, you got to recognize the bad news. And he has grief for a sin. And he wants to actually go repair that. And you see that when someone comes to Christ, they go, man, I've been an awful husband, or I've been a bad guy. I got to go make that right. I got to go have a conversation. Listen, hey, that was the old me, but God's doing a new thing in me. Then immediately you know you want to go and repair and restore the relationships you've wronged. It's evident every time someone comes to know Christ. You understand the weight of what you've done to someone, or when you were blind and you look to repair it. And not only is that going to resolve it, he's going to reward them. He's going to give them more than he ever took away from them. Why? Because he knows life's not about money anymore. He could have bought anything he wanted in that town. And he said, listen, I'm like the rich young ruler. He said, I'll give half my stuff to the poor, and I'll make it right with everyone I'm taking money from. And here's what I know. The gospel is always attached to generosity, isn't it? You can't be a stingy person and be saved. I'm convinced of it. My mom, she serves the church so faithfully ever since we started, and she's always served in lots of areas, but primarily in the cafe area. And I say, hey, Mom, if you got anybody that's being stingy, let me know, because they may not be saved. I want to talk to them. Because if you're stingy with a kolache, what are you going to do with the gospel? You know what I'm saying? Stingy people are not saved people. Generous people. They understand. Listen, I've been given something that I can never, don't deserve, and it's more, it's priceless to me. Take whatever I got. I'm going to be generous. Why? Because God has been generous to me and gracious to me. And here Zacchaeus going, take it. And if you serve kolaches, I love you. Just be generous, all right? God loves to partner with generous people. Verse 9, and Jesus said to him, today salvation has come to this house, since he is also a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost. This is a public statement. That's why it's recorded. So they grumbled about Jesus having this dinner with Zacchaeus. And here, in front of everyone, he goes, hey, this man's going to heaven. And I've come to seek and to save the lost. He was lost, but now he is found. See, Zacchaeus opened up his home and his heart, and now heaven's been opened up. Why? Because Jesus wants your heart. He wants your heart more than your habits. Why? Because where your heart is, your treasure will be also. Zacchaeus was a small man, but he made a big change. And here's my encouragement to us. Let's act like Zac and be quick to change. You know, this was Jesus' last stop through Jericho before his death on the cross. And I just want to be as kind and as gentle as I can and say, this might be your last stop. Maybe your last opportunity to seek Jesus and to change. That's just the reality of being a Christian. That's the reality of a fallen world. And that's the reality of the position I'm thinking. Can you imagine Zacchaeus that one day said, you know what? Jesus is coming through. I'm going to leave my house.
okay, I can't get through the crowds, there's some obstacles, I'm going to run ahead of the crowd, I'm going to get in the tree so I can see this man. And that man came straight up to him, he invited him to his house, and it changed his life forever. Because he made the most of that one opportunity he had. I see Steve here in the service last week. Steve had to grieve his friend losing his 15-year-old son in a car accident. Friday, before I'm heading up to the marriage retreat, I hear about Teresa Rodriguez. She serves here at the church, and some of you are following her story. Her son, Hayden, 19 years old, is being lifelighted, unconscious, hit by an 18-wheeler. And in that moment, you know, she's put in the consultation room. You know what that means. And I'm on the phone with her. And you know what we're doing in that moment? We're pleading for life. Jesus, would you bring Hayden back to life? May he live. Would you heal him? And we're pleading and crying out to the Lord. And in those moments, you don't have to remind anyone that life is precious. And Teresa's asked that the church continue to pray. We're praying for Hayden's brain right now. We're praying that his brain would function properly and be able to respond properly, that he is alive. We're praying for a full recovery for him. And I just say that one so you can pray for Teresa and Hayden, but I'm just telling you, church, it's that way sometimes. This is somebody's 49th birthday. This is somebody's opportunity to say, and I'm just telling you, if you feel Jesus calling you, receive it. Embrace it joyfully. It's God's kindness that leads us to repentance. He's trustworthy. And I'm so thankful that moment Zacchaeus hurried down that tree. I don't know what that looks like for you, but would you separate yourself from the crowd? And would you hurry down the tree when you hear Jesus call? Would you pray with me? God, thank you for the testimony of Zacchaeus. God, thank you for that day of seeking you. And God, thank you that he found out that you were seeking him. God, I know there's obstacles in our way at times, whether it be the crowd or insufficiencies in us, and God, I thank you that you're always willing to meet us where we're at. And God, I thank you for that embrace of him receiving you joyfully. God, I know that there might be people who would grumble that we have a relationship with you because they know what we've done. God, I pray for grief for our sin. God, where our hearts have become hardened. We're not even bothered by what we said anymore. God, I thank you for Zacchaeus just grief to make things right. God, would you give us that same desire to make things right where we've wronged someone? God, I thank you for Zacchaeus' generosity, that there was nothing in this world that was going to hold him back from following you and experiencing real life. And God, I just pray that we would be generous. I know there's nothing more important, there's nothing more possessed than a relationship with you, that it's that companionship, it's that fellowship, it's that friendship, it's that lordship. And God, I thank you for just Zacchaeus' openness to open up his heart and his home, and that heaven was opened up to him that day, that salvation came. And God, I thank you that you want salvation to come right now for somebody. God, what a gift if somebody hears you calling their name. Or that you want to joyfully embrace them. God, I just pray, Holy Spirit, would you just lead us irresistibly. God, I pray for our part of the whoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. And God, we know ultimately you're sovereign. You know who's going to choose you. And you know that you've chosen us before the foundations of the earth. God, I thank you that Zacchaeus may have been a small man, but he was a big change. And God, I pray we'd be quick to change. We'd be quick to make the most of the opportunities we have. God, I pray for Teresa. God, as she pleads for her son this morning, God, I pray she would feel our prayers and know that she has a church that loves her and wants to provide for her. God, I pray she would not feel alone. Lord, you say you're close to the brokenhearted. I pray that you would feel your closeness today. And God, I pray for healing for him. God, I pray in Jesus' name that his brain would begin to activate and respond appropriately to what's being asked of it. God, I pray for a full recovery in Jesus' name. For Hayden's good, but ultimately for your glory, God. God, we say you're worthy. You're worthy. And God, I pray we would respond appropriately in whatever that you're calling us.